I was born in southern Iowa, and for the first 5 years I lived on a farm. From then on, I moved into a town called Lineville, Iowa, but it's also Lineville, Missouri. That's where they got the name. So it split the town in two, and we lived there until I was a sophomore in high school.
What kind of work did your father do, that shift from the farm into town?
Yeah, he started out on the farm, but these old Iowa farms were pretty weak, pretty poorly, and poor farms. So during the Depression, or just prior to the Depression, we moved to town, and he started driving bought his own truck and drove a stock truck, or utility truck, whatever you'd want to call it, because they haul stock, they haul furniture and anything that wanted back in those days. And then he tried the oil station business. He had a gas station for a while. Oh, before he went into that, he rented his truck to the telephone company. They didn't have all their own trucks in those days, and so for about 2 years, I think, he worked with the telephone company, and we kind of traveled with him when we were not in school. And not too far from Iowa, we got into Illinois, and we got over into Nebraska a little bit, but mostly just Iowa, Nebraska, and Eastern Illinois, Western Illinois.
Did you like the moving around as a kid?
No, mm-hmm. I really didn't. I did have some experience with the schools, and I was being moved from one school to another school, and I'd have trouble explaining my name and where I lived, and I never got acquainted with the kids because we didn't stay in one place long enough. So I didn't really like that.
Were there summers that you remember as a kid where there was fun, swimming and dogs and whatever? Oh, yeah. You did in that era. What did you do for fun in that era?
We did little things like that. Go swimming out in the pond. Didn't have swimming pools, but they had ponds and reservoirs. And just other things that kids can get into, I guess. We tried about everything, I guess. Throwing rocks at each other and climbing trees and playing in the haystacks and things like that.
Even though your childhood involved a lot of moving around and that kind of thing, you know, when you look back in your childhood, did you like your childhood?
Oh, yeah. I think so.
Why was that? Because it was difficult times.
Well, I really didn't know it was difficult, you know. My mother was a school teacher, so when she was teaching, we at least had a little income. And we had, when we was on the farm, we had anything we need, all we needed to eat. Didn't have to worry about food. I know there was shortages at times, but it didn't seem to bother us younger kids. They was talking about just having one pair of shoes, and that I can remember that I never had more than one pair of shoes. You shined them up for Sunday and wore them all week. I was in Rawlins, Wyoming at the time. I was working for the telephone company, and I just knew what it was going to lead to.
Were you surprised when the attack occurred?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I didn't. I wasn't even aware of the situation, you know, of the world situation. Because we'd been married, no, 11th, no, we hadn't gotten married yet. But I wasn't taking the newspaper, wasn't reading the newspaper, really didn't know much about it. But so I was surprised, but some of the older fellows were scared. This part of the country, they were starting to move equipment some things were coming from the coast, and other military people were moving towards the coast, and day and night, trains were full too. So, but it didn't seem to involve me. I knew I was going to get caught.
Mm-hmm. Well, take me through it. How did you end up then in the Army Air Corps?
That was luck. Actually, when I went to college, Parsons College in Iowa, for 2 years, and the day that I registered for the second term, I had already filled my all my subjects up, and this girl came around and said, "We've got an opening for a pilot training. The government pays for the entire thing, and you take your college classes right here at college. Adds 2 hours to your college curriculum." So I said, well, I was pretty busy in those days because I was working my way through. But I managed to sign up for that class. Well, I had planned on going to cadets. I thought I could time it so that I'd know when I was going to be drafted, and I just volunteered just before that. And I was here in Salt Lake City. So I missed it. I got the draft notice before I could get into the cadets. I knew I had a pilot's license, but I didn't tell anybody in the service that I did until I got into Florida. And down there I had a nice lieutenant. Love was his name, and he said they're giving examinations over at another airfield there, not Drew. I can't think of the other one now, but they're giving examinations for enlisted men to join the cadets and go through the cadet program. And so he said, if you want to try, we'll provide transportation and get you over there. So I went over and sat before the board, and they accepted me. And it took quite a while. But anyway, before that, I was in the Signal Corps. So I graduated from the Signal Corps to the Air Corps whenever they took me into the cadets. So that's how I got in. And I had no idea. I had already given up that I'd be a cadet.
Take us through the training you went through then.
Well, lucked out in the Signal Corps before I got a chance to go in there. They sent me to radio school, and I learned the code and how to receive and transmit code. I figured that's going to be my job during the war, but since I got into cadets, then I had to know that in order to get through cadets, you had to be able to take 10 words a minute, and 10 and receive 10 words a minute. So we started out and took quite a procedure. They first sent me to Nashville, and that was a classification center there that they decided for you during with some of their psychological tests whether you was going to be a navigator, a bombardier, or a pilot. And I got, without telling them I'd ever flown before, I got to be a pilot. So then I went from there to just east of Memphis, and my mind's not working very good today. primary training, and I can't say it. Then I took primary training, and then we went to basic training, and I graduated I can't remember any of those places now, and I know them really well too. but
you got your wings at the end of the day, so to speak.
Yeah, in Arkansas, somewhere in Arkansas.
Are you married at this point?
Oh yeah. I got married before I got drafted, and I got drafted from right here in Salt Lake. So, And she was traveling with me from the time we got to, I left out one, Montgomery, Alabama. We spent a month or so there too. That's prior to the start of pilot training. And it's amazing that I can't remember any of those other places.
Well, you got to the point, you got your wings. What happened after that?
That's more traveling. We went from there to Tampa, Florida, and that's where our crew was formed in Tampa, Florida, and we took pilot training down there. I mean B-17 training, and I was generally under the instruction. Had a red-headed captain was my instructor, and we did a lot of the flying, and picked up our rest of our crew. They come in from everywhere, the radio schools, the gunnery schools, and a navigator and bombardier joined us there.
When you started, let me just ask you, do you remember the first time you flew in the B-17, what that was like? That was such a big airplane in that era.
I was bored. I really didn't want a B-17. I wanted to fly something a little faster and a little more maneuverable than a B-17, so, and they put me in the co-pilot seat, and I thought that was a disgrace that I didn't get to go to first pilot training, but it worked out all right in the band.
When the crew came together, what was that like? You get all these personalities from different parts of the country coming together?
I don't like to say it, but we had a mix-up. We really did. We had a Jewish boy for a navigator, and he didn't fit really well with us. We had to apologize for him not showing up a lot of times, and he's still alive, and we correspond, and we're pretty good friends, but the bombardier was a Catholic boy, and those two were in the nose together, so they didn't get along too well, and the rest of the crew apparently did pretty well. Although they did come from everywhere. Dick Cowles, was my tail gunner, out of California, but at the time he was out of Colorado. And then I picked up the engineer come out of Wichita, Kansas, and the waste gunner out of Pennsylvania, and the radio operator out of Rhode Island. The pilot came from Pennsylvania.
Who was the pilot?
Kiefer was his name. And he got into an automobile accident just before we were shipped overseas. So that's why I was doing so much flying, because he wasn't able to fly. But just before we went overseas, they said, it's okay, you can fly. So he went. And so in the museum, it's Kiefer's crew that went overseas, but he only flew 7 missions, and he passed out on the next time we started out on a mission. He completely passed out, and we had to bring him back in and put him in the hospital. We saw him once before. He came back to barracks once after that, but I got the crew then after that, except for three more missions we shared the responsibility, me and another fellow. Our crew went up by ship. Yeah.
Which ship was it?
Aquitania. Aquitania was a sister ship to the Lusitania. The Lusitania was sunk during World War I, you know. And so it was an old English ship.
What do you remember about that journey over there?
Oh, it was quite eventful. It took us 7 days. I was in charge of about 60 men, I guess. And we were in the bottom. They had put these were all enlisted men down in the hold of the ship. And the worst part about it was that they had to come through this stairway. And there was a gate there with barbed wire strung across it. They'd been bringing German prisoners over on it, and they kept them down there. And then when they put our crew down there, that didn't fit too well. And it stayed hot down in that compartment, very warm. I would take my shift, and then there was another officer took over. We was 12 hours each. But the officers got treated very well on that ship. The enlisted men didn't do so well.
How did you pass the time on 7 days?
It wasn't hard. You spent that time down below in that compartment, and that was very uncomfortable. Couldn't sleep even. It's so sweaty down there. Then I'd go up, and I had my own stateroom on the ship, so I'd get my rest up there. And we had entertainment every day, Spike Jones and his orchestra, and some USO girls were on the ship. So we had two meals a day, very elegant, very British. We'd have our fish and our about three different courses and fine silverware. So it wasn't that bad, but there wasn't much activity. We wouldn't allow too many people on the ship to have a lot of things like skeet shooting. Now there was some of that went on in the upper decks. We landed in Liverpool, but I don't know the little base or whatever it was. Maybe it's the same one I came back out on. But anyway, we were overnight there. And maybe a little longer, but not much. We weren't there very long until they shipped us to Framlingham. The first night we were there, a buzz bomb came over. And at first I didn't know what to do. I was on my way across the median, or mall, or whatever they'd call it. Parade wasn't much of a parade ground, but anyway. So everybody was diving for the revetments, I think they called them. And so I decided that would probably be a good thing to do. It didn't land that close, but that was my first night over there at our base. And of course, we didn't fly a regular mission for quite some time. We were doing practice flying, and they would come. The other members in the barracks would keep coming back from other missions, and they'd tell their stories. And we'd hear the planes coming back in, and we got into the habit of counting how many come down, how many come back, and going out to the runway sometimes and watching them come in. And it was a long, long time. There's very little activity.
When you were getting this training, once you got over there, what were they training? Like close formation flying, that kind of thing?
Yeah, mostly close formation flying.
Why was that important?
Well, I don't think it really was near as important as they said early in the war. Earlier, when the B-17s first went over, it was important because the closer they could fly together, the more guns they could train on and protect the whole group. Whereas if you're scattered out, the fighters can pick on one airplane at a time, you know. So it was easier. I mean, it was better to be together. And one plane kind of helped protect the other plane and the guns around it. But when we got there, there wasn't that many fighters. Of course, you never knew when you might be the ones that the Germans decide to pick on that day. It just happened that I never got into one of those fights where the fighters came in and knocked a lot of them down.
Do you remember the first mission?
Oh, absolutely.
Tell us the story of that.
The first thing they did before you went out, I mean, on your first mission, the pilot the co-pilot from what from one airplane would fly with a pilot of an of a crew that had been flying, and vice versa, the co-pilot from that airplane would fly with the other. You know, the crew that I flew with was flying an old airplane. I didn't know a soul because they weren't from our barracks, and you didn't know anyone except once almost the ones in your own barracks. And it was a rather short mission over to Venlo, Holland. And so first thing I did, I'd always assumed that they'd put the flak suit on as soon as you got over the water. So I didn't ask, but I went ahead and put the flak suit on. I didn't put the helmet on, but we got over the target, or near the target at least, and a piece of flak hit my window on the co-pilot side and just smashed, just ruined it, just completely smashed it in. But it was the old airplane. It was hardened glass, so it didn't come through. In the newer airplanes, it was made of plexiglass, and that would have come through and probably done some injuries. So that was I learned right then, you better be ready. And so you get a little callous at the time and a little more careless as the years go by. I mean, the missions go by. But I was...
Yeah, how many missions did you fly?
34, actually. I was given a mission for flying back from Italy. We went on the Warsaw Polish airdrop and went to Russia and down to Italy and then back. And we didn't drop any bombs, didn't carry any bombs from Italy back to the base, but they gave us credit for a mission.
Were those the shuttle missions?
Uh-huh.
Tell us about a little more in detail, what those missions were about.
Well, we didn't know ahead of time. As a crew, we didn't know he was going to be going on a mission until just shortly before. Then they told us, well, you better take your razor and your ditty bag that you usually take to go to London. Just necessities, no clothing, no... We got out the airplane and you found out you had a supply of cave rations on board. So that told you he was going to go somewhere. He'll be gone for a while. So we got in the air and I had an extra airman in that flight. That was a mix up. It was bad. The weather wasn't right, and we were supposed to go in at one altitude, and we had to keep dropping down until we were within sight of the ground. You could see things going on down below, and it was a frightful thing for a little while, because all air parachutes would be coming down beside you, and an airplane, one of our planes, one of my buddies got shot down there, and you didn't know who was shooting at who. They warned us ahead of time, the Germans are going to shoot at you, the Russians may be shooting at you too, because the Russians were trying to push the Germans out, and they didn't know. They told us they didn't know the Americans was even fighting this war.
What was the purpose of these runs from point to point?
Well, politics mostly, but we were dropping supplies to the Poles that were starving to death there in Warsaw. They had the city all bottled up. They couldn't get anything in and out, so we were dropping supplies. And there were some guns and stuff that you could see flying going down in parachutes. But I don't think it did much good. They said most, at least half of the stuff ended up in the Germans' hands anyway.
So that was the first leg of the...
That was the first leg, and we went on to Poltava, Russia from there. That's a long flight across... looking at the map, you'd think Poltava is not very far into Russia, but Russia's a big country. And it was a long flight. I think we were in the air close to 12 hours out of from from home all the way across. And then we only stood overnight there. And we flew down to Foggia, Italy. And we spent 3 or 4 days in Foggia.
What was your impression of that place?
Foggia?
Yeah.
Terrible. Italy was terrible.
Why was that?
Well, we were used to our base. We had Quonset huts, and we had a decent place for a dining hall and everything. They were in tents out in the sand. It was hot and dry. That down around Foggia is a olive-growing country, and it smelled bad because their sanitation system had been bombed. Their water pipes were laying on top of the ground. And it was bad down there, that part of town. I didn't get to go to Naples or Rome or any of the nice places. So I had a bad impression of Italy.
Were there any bombs dropped on the shuttle missions that you were on?
Yeah, we dropped bombs from Russia. We dropped on some town in Czechoslovakia. It was occupied by the Germans, but I can't remember the. It's a funny name anyway. I have it in my notes, but I'm sure some others have a better recollection of that town.
Of the basically 34 or 35 missions that you flew. You're not going to remember every mission, of course, but are there missions that stand out in your mind for one reason or another?
Yeah, there's several.
Tell us about some of the missions that stand out.
One that everybody in the crew will remember is we got a shelf through the radio room at the corner of the radio room, and there was a stack of radio transmitters in the, right behind the. The radio man sits in front of it, and then he has a desk where he operates. Well, it went through there and blew up the whole top of the airplane, cut all the cables that went back to the tail, cut the power cord to the radio, to the ball turret, and so we knew we were hit. You could see it coming. The flak, little flak bursts ahead of you, and it was right in line with us. So,
what did it feel like? As
oh,
you know, were you in the co-pilot or pilot seat?
At that? Pilot then, yes.
What did? How did you know you were hit at that?
Well,
point?
Just a thump, but we knew it was a pretty solid thump, and well, I expected it, you know. When we saw those four bushes ahead of us, and usually we used to count five. Apparently those guns were set up with a clip of five shells. And they were just right in line with us. And when that hit, I just figured, well, we got it. But I didn't know where. So I called for a count of the crew to all call in. And everybody called in, but the radio operator, he didn't call in, and the ball turret man was screaming. He wanted to get out of that turret, and he didn't have any power. He couldn't get out. So I called the waste gunner on the intercom and told him to go up and see about the radio man, because the ball turret gunner wasn't getting hurt. He had oxygen, and he could talk to us. But the radio man was completely off. So I waited a little while. I didn't hear from anybody. And so then I called Dick Cowles, who was the tail gunner, and I had him look through, and he said, "Oh yeah, the waste gunner's laying up there on the floor," and he couldn't see the radio man. So I told Dick to. And this is, I don't know whether you've ever tried calling through a B-17 from the back to the front in flight with a tank of oxygen and all the paraphernalia you have to wear. But Dick got through and revived the waste gunner first, because he had to crawl over him to get up there, and gave him a bottle of oxygen. And then they went on up to the radio room and found the radio man. He'd been knocked all the way across the room. Chair was knocked over there also. And the whole top of the airplane, like I said, was gone. And you know, we missed getting hit in the bomb bay by, oh, maybe 8 feet, maybe that much.
Were the bombs still in the bomb bay?
Yeah, oh. Yeah, we were on the bomb run. Yeah.
So did he, Kyle's pull the radio man out of the radio room then? What was his condition?
Kyle's was in good shape, but the radio man, he didn't have much. I can't remember, actually. I know we got him revived, and I talked to him. In fact, I put the co-pilot took the wheel, and I went back through the plane after we dropped the bombs, and checked on everything. The cables were all hanging down.
I was going to say, you had to walk through the radio room, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the cables were all hanging down, and I was checking to see which cable went where. And that was the first flight for the co-pilot. His first time. He was flying with me, like I told you, when they first start out. So I'm sure he had quite an experience. And we did. That was a brand new airplane. We blew a hole right through the top of it.
It's almost like the explosion went up.
It did. It did. It had to. And it just must have just barely got above it, or had taken the radio man with him too. In fact, he could have got sucked out. It would have been a possibility.
And you were able to get the ball turret gunner out, cranked out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The other two guys then, after they got settled down, they cranked him out and got him out. He was shook up a little, he went back to flying. He wasn't hurt. We flew back without any control of the tail. It was just back there flopping, but it flew all right.
That's certainly a memorable mission.
Yeah, that's our worst one. We had others that were not nearly that bad, not nearly. We had, see, the first, I told about the pilot passing out.
Why did he pass out, do you know?
Well, he had this brain injury in that car accident down in Florida. And they just cleared him and let him go. And that reacted on him, and it affected the rest of his life. He was discharged with the medical discharge. I've seen him since. He's dead now, but I saw him a couple times after that. But he didn't have he wasn't at all like he used to be.
So from the eighth mission on, you were the pilot?
That's true, except I shared it with this other fellow that got killed. We flew three missions together. We shared the responsibility. Because we were both without a crew. I mean, I had my crew, but he didn't have one. And then in one mission, that's all he got to fly with his own crew after they gave him his own. And then the bombardier did the same thing. He laid down in the nose of the airplane, and we had to turn around and come back and bring him back home too.
What happened to him?
I really thought it was all right up here. And it worked so well with the pilot, I thought, well, the bombardier just saw a way out, because he was a big man, but he was scared. And
could you understand that level of fear, that somebody could be that afraid?
I could understand what those guys said. I talked to quite a few bombardiers, and they had the same answer. They didn't have anything to do except sit there and look out the nose and the flak and everything, whereas the navigator could put his eyes in the scope and keep it from looking right out the front. So several of them had that apprehension, at least, about getting, and a lot of them did, lost their minds from it. And I think He claimed afterwards that it was an eye problem with him, that it caused him to go get dizzy and passed out. But he was discharged without a medical, so apparently, and went on to be a lieutenant colonel in the Korean War.
Are there missions that other things that occurred that stand out in your mind?
One it wasn't that's another one of our I think I should have gotten up and told about all that. We aborted more times than any other crew, I think, because we had one of the oldest airplanes that was in the squadron.
Did it have nose art on it?
No nose art. Mm-hmm. No. And no, it might have had at one time, but it didn't have when I got it. And it had more bullet holes and holes and patched. But we had to come back from a mission, and they had to change the number 3 engine. And that wasn't unusual, because one of those was going bad. Every once in a while, we'd come back with 3. But we were on another mission and loaded with bombs, loaded with gas, and everything was just checking out fine. Got down at the end of the runway and got our wheels up. Didn't even have the flaps up yet till that number 3 engine just quit. It just went to windmilling. And I didn't have any throttle control at all. And you know, when you're at that point is the most critical, when you're pulling off of the runway and no place to go but down or up. When we saw, we did go up, but it was slow, and we stayed up quite a while. So that was, it was a very dangerous, and a lot of the guys probably didn't even realize it was. But I had a good co-pilot. And
who was your co-pilot?
Joe John was. He was kind of a notorious co-pilot, but he didn't have any ambition to do anything else, and he stayed in the service and became a lieutenant colonel also. But he hit the feather button. We feathered the prop right away, and gradually got up to altitude, and then they made us fly that thing all day long, using up the gas before they'd let me land it. When I'd brought those two pilots, the pilot and the bombardier back, I didn't even ask them if I could land. I just brought them in with the load of bombs and the gas too. One time we had to take off again and go drop the bombs because they were timed and they couldn't leave them in the airplane. But
where did you just went over the channel?
Yeah, just went over the channel and dropped our bombs that one time. The other time, they didn't make me do that.
And were there missions ever where you were really low on gas? You were kind of wondering whether you were going to get back?
There was that old airplane. I wasn't in it. I was flying a new airplane. But my co-pilot was flying with another crew. He did a lot of that. So we swapped. We had a different co-pilot a lot of times. But anyway, he didn't get back. He ran out of gas before he landed in France. But we had a newer airplane and probably wasn't more efficient. Anyway, I had enough gas not to worry. But there's several of them that on that one mission had to land in France. Yeah, I never had to worry.
With the exception of that one mission where the shell came up and hit the radio room, were there any other occasions the crew members got hurt?
No one ever got hurt. One boy got a piece of hot flak in his jacket once back in the radio, in the waist. He thought he was hurt, but you know, it was just a piece of hot flak. It got stuck in his jacket and it didn't hurt. He didn't even have a little red spot was all he had.
Was there, you know, the fact that your crew came through kind of unfazed like that, or unhurt, were there any superstitions in the crew that way?
We weren't near as superstitious as many crews, because there was so much movement in the crew itself. Actually, there was only three of us that flew every mission together, just the engineer, the tail gunner, and myself. The rest of the time, it was somebody else. After we lost the bombardier, I got Buck Dunn was my toggle air.
The Iron Man.
Uh-huh. And he flew with us for 15 missions. And I think that was about right.
Was there any superstition in flying with Buck in that he had flown so many missions, people were afraid they were going to be on the mission he was finally shot down?
I don't believe so. Otherwise, I think it's just the opposite. If you had Buck on your crew, there was safer. And he
was the rabbit's foot.
I guess so.
When you mentioned that you basically got credit for that Italy to back to England mission, which constituted really your final mission. So when you flew your final combat mission, did you know it was your last mission?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. We were really keeping track.
Yeah.
We fired some flares off of that at that time. Then we went to Liverpool, and I was up there for a week or two, and came home by boat on another Liberty ship.
What do you remember about that journey going back? It seems like it'd be a little different than the one going over.
It was. It was an American ship, of course, and there was a whole room full of pilots on the cabin that I was in on, and so some of them were. It was. I don't think there was any B-17 pilots on there, but there was a lot of P-47 pilots and P-51 pilots. And we had that controversy all the time about which airplane was the best airplane. But we were treated well, as well as enlisted men were too. Good food, lots of food. Yeah.
What was it like to finally get back in the United States?
Well, I couldn't wait to get home, but it took them a while. We went to Kilmer, Camp Kilmer. And we must have stayed there a week or so, and they didn't do anything for us there. We might have checked in some of our stuff that we had from overseas, I don't remember. But from there I went to Jefferson Barracks in St. Louis. And then I was given my orders then to go to Sioux City, Iowa for the discharge, or the separation. Actually, I wasn't discharged.
Where in this little timeline did you link up with your wife?
Well, from the Jefferson Barracks, I got to go home. And she'd been working in Des Moines, Iowa all these years. I mean, when I went overseas, she went to work. And
so was it a Norman Rockwell moment, you coming up to the house? And
I did get there before she expected me, because I'd caught a plane out of St. Louis, which was rather unusual in wartime. But anyway, I got to fly back to Des Moines, and I didn't call them, tell them I was there. I got a cab from the airport and walked in on, she and my sister-in-law shared a house and the kids. So the first thing they did, my sister-in-law and my wife went shopping, left me with two girls and a boy. Youngsters, and I had never been around a baby, that is. Richard, our son, was 9 months old then. No, not that old. Maybe 6 months old. Because he was born while I was over there, so he couldn't have been that old. I didn't stop to think of that.
So you had a new mission.
Yeah. I still had to get separated, so I went over to Sioux City and got that done. And then I Well, there was a lot of period in there. I left it out. I got back from the United from England. They sent us on R&R to Tampa, Florida. You know, got down and I went home and got the wife and the boy, and we drove down to Tampa and spent 10 days down there. From there, we went to Memphis, Tennessee, and I was assigned to the ferry command. So I got to fly a B-17 one more time. In the ferry command, I picked up a B-17 out in Kansas and flew it to Albuquerque, New Mexico, where they're going to junk it. And I flew the C-47s there, and also then they transferred us to Fort Dix, New Jersey, and I flew the ATC there, transportation. I flew to Kansas City, Chicago. I mean New York to Kansas City, back and forth. And also, I was with the hospital aircraft, and we flew veterans. I mean injured personnel from the East Coast. We pick them up down in Charlottesville, I believe it was Charleston. We'd pick them up in Charleston from the ships, no, from the airplanes. And we'd pick them up from the ship up in New York. If they come in by ship, well, we'd pick them up there and fly them to the hospital nearest their town. We carried a crew member, I mean a real woman nurse, a male nurse, and an engineer, and co-pilot and pilot. And that was interesting, and you felt like you was doing a good deal. We'd fly as far west as Wichita, Kansas, and jumping around little towns. And then we'd wait in Wichita until we get enough patients coming from the west coast, from the Pacific battle. And then we'd do the same thing, scatter them around the east coast. And we took them to, well, my last flight ended up in Atlanta, Florida. We had dropped a patient off up at, I think it was Rome, Georgia, if there is such a town. Just one patient there. And so we stayed in Atlanta that night and flew back to New Jersey, and that was it.
During any of that time, had you considered staying in the service?
No, not really. They offered me to stay. They needed those C-47 pilots. For the job that I was on, and they offered to let me stay in a year, but I had a job with the AT&T before the war, and it was being held for me, so I knew I could get a job when I got out, and I'd planned. That wasn't a good experience. I mean, after I got out, I always stayed back in for a while.
What's your perspective now at the age you are now, and you think about that young kid you were going over there? What do you think now about that?
Oh, I don't really know. It's a good thing we went over there as kids, I'll say that. Because as you got older, you began to think, was it worth it? And we didn't consider it. At that time, we didn't consider whether it was worth it or not. We had to be done is the way we felt then. So I nowadays, looking back, a lot of things could have been different.
Although, when you do look back, are you proud of your time in service?
Yeah, I guess so. I guess it's proud, but I also feel like I was pretty lucky. Very lucky.